A lot of you guys have had the pleasure of being parents, and you know something of what it's like to have that joy of bedtime. Bedtime's a great time, a transition time. Not only because, partly because it means there's about to be some quiet in the house, right? But one of my joys of being a parent, being a dad, is that I've always enjoyed having reading time with my children. It's always the honor to get to be the one who did that. And now as Luke has gotten older, he doesn't need to be read to quite the same way, but sometimes he and I will sit down and we'll read together. And it's our ritual to do that before he goes to bed. But sometimes, well, we get a late start, and it's time for bed. It's after time for bed. There's not much time, but he wants to make sure we get a story in somehow. And I say, well, I'll just do a Bible story. Let's just do a Bible story. And he said, yeah, tell me one I don't know. And so I'll do one I don't think he knows. But I've been doing this for a long time now, and guess what? I'm running out of Bible stories that I know, or at least I know the details of. And I'm not sure what I'm going to do sometimes. And this past week was one of those times. It was late, and we had to. I said, I'll just do a Bible story. Well, Dad, it's got to be one you don't know. I don't know. I said, well, there's one I'm preaching on. Do you ever hear the story of Zechariah? And I wondered about you as a congregation. Do you remember the story? I mean, you remember Susan's retold it, but there was parts of that story you probably knew about Mary, who's pregnant and goes to see her older relative, Elizabeth, who's also now pregnant with John the Baptist later in the story. And remember how she went, we'll hear more about that maybe next week. But then Mary breaks out into singing this joyful song. We call it Magnificat. It's a reversal of fortune where God takes those who are powerful and misusing their power and brings them down and will bring up through this one Jesus, bring up those who have been brought low, will bring them high, will bring the poor and the oppressed up. That's the opening song in the gospel in the Gospels. But we also have Zechariah's song. And so there's the rest of the story. So I remember telling the rest of that story that Susan shared with us. Now, first off, you got to remember that Zechariah and Elizabeth, well, as we Protestants would say, they were PKs, preacher's kids. They were born into the priestly caste that had gone all the way back to Moses' brother Aaron. And everyone in that caste had something to do with being a priest, except because she's a woman in those days, you couldn't be a priestess. But her main job was to help her husband out. He was to be a priest and to maybe be able to encourage him and, of course, to have a baby. And we find out today that they were both honorable people. They were righteous people. Now, when you hear the word righteous in the Bible, sometimes we think self-righteous, but that's not what we're talking about. A righteous person is someone who does what? Loves God with their heart, mind, soul, and spirit, and loves their neighbor as yourself. A righteous person is someone who lives the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And that's what you ought to think when you hear the word righteous. Someone who wants to be in right relationship, to do the right thing with people they have relationship with. And they were both rock solid human beings. Now, we find out something else. We find out something painful. Elizabeth, as it says in the Bible, is barren. Now, this is a patriarchal society, and all the blame goes to the woman if she's barren. And unfortunately, in those days, her one job is to do what? Only to bring a baby into this world and to raise that child, especially a baby boy. And I always hesitate when I preach on this text because I know it's going to be a painful story. We have people who've lost children, and we have people who can't have children. But it is, nonetheless, the situation of this woman that we hear and we focus on, the love in which we see coming through this story. So they can't have a child. She's a broken person. This has gone on year after year. They've prayed, they've prayed, they've prayed, they've begged, they've no telling how many times when he's been to the temple, he's been in the worship at the temple, and he prays and sends his prayers up, and the incense goes up, and the prayer goes through, but still, she doesn't have a child. And he doesn't divorce her. He could divorce her because, well, that's the right in the Old Testament law. You have that privilege. If you can't have, she can't have a baby, you can find someone else who might have one, right? But he's a righteous man. You know what a righteous person does? They don't just do the prerogative and do what they think they can get by with because the law says I can do that. No, they do what's right. They do what's loving. And he loves Elizabeth. And I know she must love him. They were a close couple. He doesn't divorce her, even though it was great pain for both of them. And so that's the setting of our story. And there's this pain. And then we find out that his priestly group, there's a group that he goes to the temple for a month, and they serve in the temple for a month doing various duties. There's lots of people that go do this. But they draw lots, because the greatest job of all is to be able to go into the Holy of Holies. The Holy of Holies is this little tiny room in the center of the temple. It's got a throne, it's got cherubim, angels on the side, gold. And this is the living room of God. This is the place where God resides. And no one dares go into this place unless it's a priest. And it's once a month to bring the incense, to burn the incense. All the prayers of the people, the assembly that are assembled outside can be taken up to the Lord and to clean the temple, to clean that room. And he only goes here once. You can only go once in a lifetime if you get chosen. Only once. And most people never get to go to a priest. And Zechariah gets chosen to go into the Holy of Holies. What an honor. What an amazing honor for him. And he goes and he's going to try to do the right and proper thing. Send up the incense. No doubt his prayer is a part of this, right? That prayer he's prayed all these years. He finally gets in the Holy of Holies. Don't you think he's going to send that prayer up? But everything changes because an angel appears. And the angel says, don't be afraid. Angels always have to tell us this, right? I'd want to hear that more than once, by the way. Don't be afraid, for God's found favor with you. Just like he says to Mary, God has good news for you. You're going to have a son. Elizabeth is going to bear a son, not just any son, not just that good news. That would have been great news on and of itself. He said, no, this is going to be the forerunner, the one who will come before and announce the Savior that we've long waited for hundreds of years as a people we've waited for is going to come. And your son, John, and you will name him John, will be the one who will announce and bring many people back to the faith and prepare people to receive this one who is coming. And John goes, well, let me get this. How can I know this is really going to happen? I mean, you know, she's a little, I'm old, and this has been a really long time, and I'm not sure how this thing's going to go. And the angel's like, huh? What? I'm giving you this joyful news you've been waiting for all your life to hear, and I tell it to you, and you're like, doubting this? I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and if I say something, it's going to happen. And at that point, Zechariah can't speak. The angels press the mute button on him. Pulls the batteries out of that sucker, and it's not coming back on for 9 months. 9 months later, the baby comes and is delivered. And still can't speak. But they go to do the naming ceremony. And in the naming ceremony, the father's supposed to name him, but he can't speak. So Elizabeth says, he's going to be called, they've communicated before, he's going to be called John. Oh, no one wants to believe her. She's the mother. She's the woman. And John writes out, his name is John. And then he says, his name is John. What? And out of silence, he speaks, and his voice is heard. And wow, there's something amazing happening here. They know this is not just any child. This is not just any birth. And his voice is recovered. Now, it's a rather different story, don't you think? It's different because, well, it's in the Old Testament, too, of course. We've got Sarah and Abraham waiting for a baby. We got Jacob and Rachel had to wait for a baby. They had their struggles. But here again, we have that tradition. We have this older woman bringing birth to a child by a miracle that happens from God. So I was thinking about the story. There's several things about it that I really like. I love the story because there's two things. The first time I've read it, and the first time I think I've preached on this part of the story, and I heard two things I wanted to share with you. One thing was very simple, and that is that I don't think Elizabeth was the real barren one in this story. Oh, she had struggles, but the real barren one was Zechariah. Because when he entered that temple, he'd been praying for years for a child. And he'd been disappointed time and time and time again. So even when the angel comes and gives the good news and says, hey, this is all about to change, man. Your prayers have been heard. You're in the temple of the Holy of Holies. And guess what? It goes up. God heard the prayer. But he didn't believe. Why do you think he didn't believe? I mean, he's a faithful, righteous man. I think he doesn't believe. The reason I wouldn't have believed. Well, I've been disappointed how many times? I've been hoping and hoping and hoping and hoping. And I guess, I think I see him going through the motions again and again, praying the prayer, praying the prayer. I'll pray it again and pray it again. That's really going to happen. And there's a kind of cynicism. Nothing's really going to happen. He lacks an imagination. In other words, I think Zechariah is the one who's really barren. Because barren in the sense that he lacks, he cannot conceive, pardon the pun, of God doing something in his situation, or God doing something in Israel. It's not just Zechariah, it's the whole nation of Israel that's barren. They've been waiting for hundreds of years for the Savior to come, and the Savior has not come, and they've endured all kinds of injustices and all kinds of oppression, first from the Greeks, and then they've got the Romans on them. And now you hear this good news. Are you going to risk getting hope up again? Do you want to be disappointed again? But that's what happens. So I think Zechariah was barren. In the same way, we as a people can be barren, lacking imagination to realize how God can act in our world and act in our lives in ways that we don't really fully understand and expect. Maybe not like we imagine it or we pray for it, but always God is acting in some new way. And so I was thinking about how that's true in our own families this weekend. I've been reading a novel which I really like a lot. It's called Promise. It's about Tupelo, Mississippi, where I served a church for 6 years back in Mississippi. Tupelo in 1936 was hit by the third worst disaster of tornadoes in our nation, a Class 5 tornado came through town, killing hundreds and hundreds. I think just under 1,000 people were killed in Tupelo. Wiped out vast parts of the city of Tupelo. It shook the city. Even to the day I lived there, it was still affecting the city. In some ways, we're actually positive. But there was great pain and story about that. As you can imagine, all those lives were wiped out in a short moment. But what came to mind as I was reading, I was thinking about the family, or two families, a black family and a white family, and they're interrelated by some things that happened between them, and I won't go into the details. But the white family stood out for me because I was thinking about them. They have all the appearance of being the prominent family. He's a judge, and they're wealthier people, and they're whites in a time when whites and blacks were oppressed. And all of a sudden, you have this family that's struggling because, well, the woman, they had a child, but she's got postpartum depression. Why is she depressed? What happens sometimes, we know. It just happens after pregnancy. But she was already probably depressed. She had a husband who didn't take her seriously, who minimized her as a woman, and who she felt a sense of lostness. And she struggles to do everything, to get up and care for that baby. And their oldest son's a no good. He's turned out as bad can be. All the privilege, everything given to him, he's running with the wrong crowd. He gets a woman in the other family pregnant, who the black family rapes her. He's turned out awful, and they don't know what to do about him. And the husband's way of dealing with this lack of affection, because the wife has withdrawn from him, is to just disappear to his work and have an affair with somebody else. And I think about that story, and I think about us in family life. We don't have, most of us, things quite as dramatic as that, but we've got things we struggle through. We've got children who struggle through things like that. We feel the pain that they go through. We wonder, how can we help them? How can we help? How can we change this situation in our lives, in my own life? We often find we don't know what to do. We feel stuck. We pray about it. We pour ourselves out. God, help us. How long, O Lord, will this go on like this? Can you find a new way to bring new life into the life that we're struggling with? And you wait. And we deal with that. Then I thought about the barrenness of our nation. We're in a time, it's a different time. We haven't always been like we are right now. Remember back in the 1960s, and we believed in the institutions of government. We understood that things could happen and that people could go to the moon. John Kennedy could say, you know, not because it's easy, but because it's hard, we're going to do this. And we believe, yeah, we can do this. But we live in a very different time now. People don't believe in the institutions of government. They feel, we don't believe in our president. We don't believe in our Congress. We don't believe in the institutions that we trust in, that we've always trusted in, that we depend upon. So many of us are very cynical about that. Left or right, conservative or liberal, we have a kind of cynicism that's fallen upon us. Even though, and this is true, almost 60%, a little bit over 60% of us as American citizens agree on some major solutions to some major issues like immigration. We largely agree. There are some ways that we can find commonality in gun control. There are ways that we even agree on ways of finding some commonality on the issue of abortion. I mean, imagine that. We talk about income disparity. We realize there's problems there we got to deal with. We talk about there not being enough money taking care of the weak, or we talk about imprisonment, how many people are in prison, and we recognize that's a problem. We agree. Both sides of the aisle, as they would say. But nothing seems to happen. There's a kind of barrenness, a longing. We get cynical. And we get cynical, we start thinking, oh, they're all the same, all those politics. And even though it's not true, when we look at the news media, we say, well, the news media is awful. We can't trust the news media. Even though it's my experience that news media is largely correct in the truth that they say, it's the spin that's often given that makes us not trust it. So we're in a kind of barren time as a nation. A barren time. That brings us to the second thing I realized when I read the story this time. And the second thing I had thought about this before is that I thought, well, the silence may be more gift than curse. You know, it sounds like it, and it is a consequence. He did something he didn't believe, and the angel gave a consequence, right? And, well, he's been punished. Well, you know, when you have kids and you give them a timeout, ever give your kid a timeout? There's a lot of different ways of doing that. You can give your kid a timeout and you can say, I've had enough. I'm not putting up with this anymore. You go to your room. You don't come down until I tell you to come down. And the kid goes crying. It's punishment time. The other way of going about that is, I'm really frustrated. You know, I think we both need some time apart. I want you to go up in your room and rest and think about it and give me some space, and you can have some space, and we'll come back and we'll talk about this later on. Not quite the same, is it? And I think that's what happens with Zechariah. He's been given a timeout. But I think it's less punishment and more needed time, because silence is so important. In fact, I think Zechariah, as one person says it, can be the patron saint for our time, because silence is the one thing we don't do much and don't do well in our society. Ride around in your car. How many of you don't have any noise? Maybe a few. You ever have the radio on? Turn the news off. How about the television? People, I know people who have their television on all the time because they can't stand the silence. I've had the biggest discussions of worship teams. If we're planning worship, hey, there's too much silence between this and that in worship. Oh, we shouldn't have any silence. Oh, people will get bored and go, oh, you know, it won't be right. All that noise, it just goes on and on and on, and we're always thinking about something. And listen, tune into television, and everyone got an opinion on everything, and here are the solutions for this, and here's the problems here, and here's how we're going to resolve this. This is what's going to happen here next. Everyone's got an opinion. But silence is powerful. Tune out so that we might tune in is a discipline of faith that has largely been lost. Because when you tune out from all these voices, not just all these voices out here, and sometimes I get tired of hearing myself speak, but also the voices up here, to let them go. Always trying to fix a problem, always trying to figure out a solution, always anticipating the next problem that's going to come. Just sometimes let it go, and in letting it go, wisdom comes. I remember once I had a spiritual director that I really liked, and I'd go to about once a month, and he was really helpful to me, and I would just start spilling all my neurotic things I've been dealing and struggling with and thinking about, and where was God and all this, where was God and all this. And one time he just sat there. He just listened. He wouldn't say a word. I kept going on and on and on. And finally I said, aren't you going to say something to me? He said, no. Not until you have something to say. I said, well, I've been saying. No. Sit in silence. And what you need to say will come. And it came. After a long silence. Because God speaks. Creativity happens in silence. If you're always running around, you're never going to really hear what God's got to say. Tune out so you can tune in. And in the silence, the wisdom of the Spirit often comes. Clear your mind in meditation. Silence. And let the Spirit speak. And God will speak in God's time when you're ready to hear it. It may not be exactly what you're looking for. It may not be as it was for Elizabeth, for someone, you know, a baby. But God will speak. That's what happens in the story of Zechariah. Zechariah is given 9 months to be quiet, to listen and tune to the Spirit. This barren man, not the barren woman. And God speaks, and his joy gathers as he understands the wonders of what God is. And he, when he starts to speak, he can't quit. He starts to sing like Mary sings, like we can sing. Advent is a time for silence, for pulling apart from the noise of the world to listening and preparing for the Christ child and being ready to receive what the Christ child will give us. May we be here every week for worship. I promise a surprise and something wonderful every week if you come. God will speak, but let us be prepared and let us be listening.